What's going on, everybody? Pastor Brandon here. Welcome to Sunday School. It's going to be another great opportunity for us to experience the presence of the Lord. And what I love about Sunday School is that it's your chance to just go a little bit deeper in your biblical understanding of all of the topics that we are tackling as a congregation. And so today is going to be no different. I have always loved Sunday School. I was just with my dad in Phoenix, Arizona, and we were talking about how he was a Sunday school teacher, and he was telling me that I was following in his footsteps, and I said, well, I must be following pretty closely because we used to skip Sunday school growing up, and we would get McDonald's. And so I just, a lot of fond childhood memories when I think about Sunday school, when I think about a father leading his family to know Jesus just a little bit deeper. And so I endeavor with the same motives to take you further in the presence of the Lord. And you even have permission to go grab something to eat while we're going through our Sunday school lesson today, all right? So I'm so excited just to be sharing and to be diving deeper in the presence of the Lord with you. It's going to be a great time as we begin to see everything that God has for us. It's just a great day to love Jesus. Also, did not our hearts burn over the last few services, Pastor Khalil Tubbs and Pastor Marshawn McKinney, did they not do a tremendous job giving us the word of God? And I'm so grateful to experience the gift and the grace that God has placed on their lives. Let me also, I have good home training. Let me not act like I don't see you all. Good morning in the comments. I see you down here. Ebony, I see you. Good morning. Shakirian, I see you. Good morning. Hannah, good morning. Naquita, good morning. Josh, good morning. It's so good to see all of you here in the comments. I know it's early, okay? I know it's early, but your intentionality at going deeper in the Word of God is commendable. Many of you are about to experience God's best and God's blessed life for you. And in order for you to sustain that, you're going to need to know His nature and His character. And the best way that you can do that is by going into the Word of God. And that's what we're going to do here, all right? So everybody that is present, Crystal Reed, I love you. I was just praying for you and your family, and so happy to see you in the comment section, all right? So do me a favor, guys. Just tag a couple of people. Make sure that by the time they wake up, they'll have access to information that I think that they're going to desperately need to know how to navigate their future, all right? This is Sunday School. Here we go. This installment of Sunday School is really near to my heart as we are diving into the Exodus story, and we're in a brand new series here at Reformation Memphis entitled The Exodus, and I'm excited about it, but I wanted to give just a brief overview, probably for the next 20 minutes or so. I'm not going to be long, but I want to give you a brief overview of the book of Exodus so that you'll be thoroughly prepared by the time 9 a.m. rolls around and we're full steam ahead in our narrative and in our story, all right? So it is important that you understand the book of Exodus. And here's the first thing that I want you to write down. I want you to make sure that you don't miss this. The book of Exodus is the second book in the Pentateuch. Now, you're wondering, what is the Pentateuch? That's a good question, all right? The Pentateuch is the first five books of the Old Testament: Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. The first five books of the Old Testament, it is affectionately referred to by scholars as the books of the law. So when we reference the Pentateuch, I do not want you to think that there is a separate Bible, okay? We are talking about the same Bible. But when we're referring to it in that nature, it's talking about the first five books of the Bible, all right? So if that's new information for you, rejoice and receive. But if it's old information, make sure you just don't forget it, okay? So we are talking about the first five books of the Bible, the first five books of the Old Testament. We're talking about where it's also known as the Torah, okay? It's known as the Torah. It's also referred to as the law. Can I give that to you again? And all my preaching lab students should be saying amen. All right, let me give it to you again. It's the first five books of the Bible, the first five books of the Pentateuch, which is also known as the Torah or the books of the law. That's just important for you to know because you need to know how to navigate your Bible. Can I just say that to you? In a day of doctrinal darkness, in a day where we are living and thriving in blissful ignorance, I want to tell you, you need to know how to navigate your Bible. Beyond growing because you have forgiven someone or you can now go to lunch with people and now you don't cuss people out, can we just save that elementary growth? That's stuff I got to do at Sunday morning at 9 a.m. But for this 7 a.m. crowd who is determined to grow in the Word of God, that's low-hanging fruit, right? At some point, we're not going to just rejoice only, whoo, I forgave them. Ooh, took my mama out to lunch. Woo. Okay, at some point, we're going to have to kind of grow a little bit further, and we start to know how to handle our Bible. Okay, so that's important because I'm talking to mature believers that are growing in the Word of God, that are ready to see everything that God has promised them and not just see it for themselves, but for the person beneath them in the comments. Amen. All right, so the book of Exodus, you're going to find that Exodus is just so referred to so many times, so frequently. You're going to see that that narrative is going to be revealed to you so many times throughout the Word of God. And I want to just extract a few opportunities, a few chances for you to just see that Exodus is a narrative that is used a lot in the Bible, okay? In Psalm 37, write down Psalm 37, P-S-A-L-M, Psalm 37, you're going to see that David is going to receive assurance that he is, that God remembers him and is going to rescue Israel out of Egypt, right? So it's just a comparison and contrast. In Psalm 37, it is the depiction that God remembers David and will rescue him like how he rescued Israel out of Egypt. So that's a reference to the Exodus narrative. Not only there, but you're going to see that the prophet Jeremiah is going to compare future gatherings of Israel to the similar exodus out of Egypt. You can find that in Jeremiah 16 and 14. All I'm doing is just giving, substantiating my claims that Exodus is referred to a lot in your Bible, okay? Even the return of Jesus and his parents from Egypt is associated with the Exodus. That's Matthew chapter 2, verse 13 and 15. You're going to also see that the book of Exodus is a foundational understanding of God's plan of salvation throughout the Bible. Let me give it to you again. The Exodus is a foundational understanding. The book of Exodus, please hear me, is a foundational understanding of salvation throughout the whole Bible. Please write that down. Do not forget that. Be a good class. You're in Sunday school. If you got to watch the replay, you're watching me on the replay. That's totally fine because I know you're getting dressed for church because church starts at 9 a.m. and you're going to be on time. So I get it. But I want to make sure that you know that the theme, that the objection of salvation can be traced in its foundation to the book of Exodus, right? It's not just seen in Jesus. It's not just seen in the Gospels. You can find the foundational premise of salvation. You can find it in the book of Exodus. And that's really good news. What's amazing news, and I'm going to hurry because I don't want to go over time, and our incredible production crew that's here with me, they do such a phenomenal job. They're keeping me on time. But I got to tell you that the beauty of the Bible, it does not contradict itself if you have proper interpretation. What I love about the Bible is that I can see a narrative and a theme weaved throughout all of the books of the Bible communicating one story. Mankind was made in God's image. Mankind rebelled against said God. God loved mankind enough to pursue with salvation and plans for redemption. He loved us enough that throughout every book of the Bible, he is constantly reminding us of deliverance and salvation. That's really good news, all right? So I need to give you that. Exodus is also a book of deliverance. And can I just challenge all, you shouldn't, in my humble estimation, you should not be a deliverance worker and you are not familiar with the entire book of Exodus. I would almost venture to say that it's criminal. It's not criminal, but I feel like it is. It is dangerous to say, come out, devil, and you have no foundational understanding of the original come out, right? Which is in the book of Exodus. Now, you can leap over into the Gospels and Jesus can be your example, and you can cast devils out, sons of Sceva style. Amen. I'll just leave it there. But if you're going to understand your authority, then you should understand your history. Amen. If you're going to understand your authority, then you should understand your historicity. What that means is I know the authority that I have because I am familiar with the history of salvation, right? I'm talking from a theological lens. I'm talking from a biblical lens. And I want to encourage every person that's about to hit the share button right now, go ahead and do it. I want to encourage every deliverance person, every person that works altars, every person that gets on the side of an ear and declares and whispers in that ear the different prophetic exhortations that bring people into freedom. You need to know the Exodus story. Amen. Put that in the comments. I need the Exodus story. Please put that in the comments. I need the Exodus story. You need to know the book of Exodus. Why? Because one of the themes of the book of Exodus is deliverance. Deliverance of the Jewish people from Egypt was interpreted as a prototype of God's freeing of all of his people. You can even see this prototype take place in Jesus through the church. I use those words very carefully because I don't want to cause confusion. Coming into freedom in Jesus can happen through the local church. Right now, you are a part of a local church virtually, right? We're going to Sunday school. And what I am communicating to you is that through this agent, primarily pointing to the Lord Jesus Christ, you can come out of whatever bondage and whatever ties your soul is in right now. Amen. All right, that's good news, okay? So the book of Exodus is a book about deliverance. Every deliverance worker that loves to scream, come out, should have some foundational training and understanding of the book of Exodus. It is incredibly important for the things that you say that God has called you to do in a deliverance context. Not only is it a book about deliverance, but it's a book about sacrifice, okay? So write down the word deliverance. Number one is deliverance. Number two is sacrifice. Number one is deliverance. Number two is sacrifice. In the book of Exodus, a sacrificial system is going to be presented, is going to be birthed, whereby which man can now approach God. You cannot, I don't want to make nobody upset, but Lord Jesus, you cannot approach God without sacrifice. Now, I can hear the New Testament people screaming at the top of their lungs, come out of the law. But I'm not living in the law. Jesus came to fulfill said law. But Jesus Christ is the sacrificial lamb. You still can't come to God without the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, okay? So I want to be very clear. You need a sacrificial system. I'm just so grateful and I'm just so godly indebted that he would send his own son wrapped in flesh and that mirrors divinity, that there is no second class and there is no second watered down version of God in Jesus. Jesus is God. And Jesus, through a sacrificial system, is high priest. I'm getting ahead of myself. And Jesus is sacrificial lamb. And he offers himself up to the wrath of God because God is not a bully. God is perfect love because he is perfect justice. He must punish sin because if he does not, then he is not all sufficient love. If there is no demarcation between the infraction of sin and the beauty of holiness, then we have no God. All we have is a country club. But because God is just, hallelujah, I'll save it for later. Because God is just, he must judge sin. And I'm so glad that Jesus took on the sins of humanity because we could not meet the righteous wrath of God. Therefore, my friends, sacrifice has always been a part of the plan of God. Sacrifice has always been a part of the approaching of God. Sacrifice is not a curse word, no matter what the modern day church and the social standards of the day would try to communicate to mankind. Sacrifice is entry-level Christianity. Did you hear what I said? Can I take it a step further? How about self-sacrifice is entry-level Christianity? Pastor Brandon, what does that mean? How is self-sacrifice entry-level Christianity? Well, Christ is not Jesus's last name. It is his endowment. It is his anointing. Therefore, my friends, if you're going to have that precious oil, if you're going to be a Christ-like one, then we must ask ourselves, what did Jesus Christ do in order to open up a doorway for other believers to become Christians? Guess what he did? It's an easy question to the test. He sacrificed himself. And in sacrificing himself, we can draw our logical conclusion that self-sacrifice is entry-level Christianity. We want to be so many things other than entry-level believers. We want to be prophets. We want to be apostles. We want to be pastors. We want to be deliverance workers. We want to be all of the things about Christianity that draw attention to us, that solicit hand claps and itinerant schedules. But can I tell you more than anything that what God is looking for, in my opinion, in this latter day reign, in this end time opportunity, and I know you're getting nervous now, but what I think God is looking for is just authentic believers. That's it. I don't think he's looking for gospel superstars. I don't think he's looking for anybody's name to be in lights because of their own talents. I think God is just looking for authentic believers that understand entry-level Christianity, self-sacrifice. And the people of God said amen. Amen. All right. So that's deliverance number one. Number two is sacrifice. Elder Vanessa, pray for me. I'm doing my best. Number one is deliverance. Number two is sacrifice. A sacrificial system is initiated and inaugurated in the book of Exodus. And then number three is the priesthood. This is just an overview of the book of Exodus. Number three is the priesthood. You're going to find in the book of Exodus that the introduction to the priesthood is going to be made manifest in our reading. This is important because of God's sacrificial system. He does not, making everybody upset today. Because of God's sacrificial system, you can't just walk up on God because you feel like making a sacrifice. that's just not the way it works. You can't just say, oh, I had a dream and I'm ready to sacrifice. Oh, no. You do that, that'll get you killed. Now, this is specific to the Old Testament and the law. But can we take the great theological leap over into the new covenant? And can we just please tap the sons of Sceva on the shoulder and just say, hey, fellas, would you please testify about what it means to do something God didn't call you to do? Amen. The devil beat them senseless. So I'm not saying that you're going to die if a natural death if you start doing stuff that you weren't called to do. But I'm sure going to tell you, you're going to waste time. You might waste energy. You might waste a whole lot of resources trying to be something that you just think you deserve a chance to be. This is Sunday school, so I'm just diving a bit deeper into our apologetic resources in order to convince you not just only of the believability of Jesus Christ, but I'd love a chance to convince you that as the priesthood is instituted in the law and in the Pentateuch and in the book of Exodus, what it does is that it identifies that not everybody can come behind the veil into the Holy of Holies where the sacrifice is made. This is uniquely used for the priesthood, right? And Aaron, Moses' brother, is going to be the first priest, and he is going to be charged to give birth to a lineage of priests. And I'm so glad that Jesus Christ is the great high priest. And many scholars believe that the book of Exodus and the book of Hebrews mirror each other when it comes down to talking about the priesthood. But this is a great place to say amen, that Jesus Christ is our great high priest, that he would go before God with blood on his hands, and it is his own sacrificial blood as he is presenting himself upon the proverbial mercy seat, that even behind the veil, that don't you remember in the Gospels, I feel the Holy Ghost, and that is strange. I wasn't anticipating that. Don't you remember in the Gospels that the veil was torn, not from the bottom to the top, because that could suggest that man could do that. That thing was torn from the top to the bottom as if it were God tearing the veil. Why? Now you and I can come boldly before the throne of grace to obtain mercy. That is mercy. That does not give us the right to start a church. I'm going to leave that alone. Amen. But I had to put that in there because we assume coming boldly before the throne of God means making entrepreneurial ventures of the gospel. Lord Jesus, just because you can come boldly before God's presence and obtain mercy, and your prayers can ascend unto the right hand of the Father as a sweet incense. Yes, it can. And you can have access to God, and you can worship God, and you can hear from the prophetic spirit of the Holy Ghost, and you can be moved in your heart to fast and to pray for other people. But please hear me. These are not rites of passages for us to just call ourselves into the office gifts that were given to the church for ministry. Just because you have a relationship with God does not mean that you can just deem yourself something. Can I just be very honest? And I hope this is not offensive. God knows I love Bishop S.Y. Younger, but he is not a Clack. Amen. Therefore, my friends, I have no foresight on how I'm going to split Noah's inheritance with Bishop S.Y. Younger. That's my friend. He and I have relationship. He and I have conversation. He and I even give gifts, and I sow into his ministry for the things that God will do for his life. But can I please tell you that there is nothing in me that feels obligated to make provision for him in a way that I have called my son, Lord Jesus, to be a representative of my lineage. Does that make sense to you? Well, so it is in a kingdom concept. Just because you have a relationship with God does not mean you can call yourself into things that you are not uniquely designed to be a part of. If you do, you may find yourself running the risk of running into a season called Skeva. All right, I'm gonna leave that right there. Amen. Okay. All right, so the book of Exodus, it is the exit, right? It is also deliverance. It is also sacrifice. It is also the priesthood. And what I love about it is that it does have a central figure. His central figure is God, number one. And then the secondary figure that I'd like you to pay attention to is Moses. Now we can extract all types of definition and information about God. He is the primary figure in all of the biblical canonicity and all of the references in the Bible, of course. But I'd like to focus specifically on Moses. Now, Moses is a major figure in the Exodus story. Moses is a prophet. You can go to Deuteronomy 18 to see that. Moses is a prophet. Moses was uniquely selected, even what some would even say, maybe even against his own will. He was selected by God to be a mouthpiece and a deliverer, because whenever God gets ready to do something for his people, here it comes, newsflash, God's going to use somebody. Oftentimes, God's going to use a man. God is going to use a woman. God can use a child. God uses people to deliver people. Can you put that in the comments? And please never forget it, as Sunday school is coming to its conclusion. God uses people to deliver people. Never forget that God uses the frailty and the falsehoods and the frustrations of people to deliver other people. If you are waiting for a perfect person to come along and to pull you out of your sinking sand, you're going to drown. You want to know why? Because God uses flawed people. Okay, you need to not forget that. So Moses is a central figure. He's a main character of who God is going to use, as you're hitting that share button really quick one more time, of who God is going to use to bring his people out. The book of Exodus is the exit. The book of Exodus is the exit. The purpose of the book of Exodus is to show how God's promises to Abraham was fulfilled when the Lord rescued the Israelites. Please don't forget that. Israelites, Israel, Jacob, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. I can't take you back through the journey through Genesis, but Exodus is the continued story of the book of Genesis. God is showing his covenant love by keeping his promises. I wish I had time. I got to tell you, he's a promise keeper. I have to tell you, no matter what bondage you find yourself in, he keeps his promises. No matter what frustration you find yourself in, he keeps his promises. If God has to tag in plagues, he keeps his promises. There is nothing that can stand between God and a fulfilled promise. Now, that's good news. So the book of Exodus is going to show how God's promises to Abraham is kept because the Lord rescues the Israelite descendants of Abraham from Egyptian bondage. It is also going to explain the origin of the Passover, right? We just celebrated. Well, we're getting ready to celebrate Passover, and I don't want to fight with you, but we're getting ready to celebrate Passover in a few weeks. But amen. Easter was in March. Hallelujah. It was wonderful and a great time. The book of Exodus tells us a moving story about the mighty God, the creator of the universe. He goes beyond the limitations of time. You already know that. What I really need you to know about this is that this is the exit. This is God pulling his people out of bondage because of covenant promise. This is, and I'm going to say this again in my introduction when I'm preaching at 9 a.m., so just act surprised. But you need to know that the major figure of the book of Exodus is an unusual man. Here it is. Who God used 80 years of preparation that was equally divided between the palace and the pasture. Don't you forget that. It'll be important in a few hours, but you need to know this man goes through 80 years of preparation before he is fully moving in a ministerial expression. Look right at me. This man goes through 80 years of preparation before he operates in ministerial expression. 40 years in the palace, 40 years in the pasture. Because God will prepare a man before he sends a man. Amen. I'll just leave that there. For whatever reason, we have a love-hate relationship with preparation. We are excited about preparation in its beginning stages because it announces we're about to get to do something. But then when preparation goes beyond our timetables and time frames for what we're comfortable with, we will curse preparation and start to find words and opportunities for us to express what we think we've already learned. My friends, that is my time for Sunday school, and that is our overview of the book of Exodus. If you're anywhere in the Memphis, Tennessee area, finish getting dressed and get to church. You got about 90 minutes before everything is going to kick off, but I want to make sure that you are getting yourself prepared and ready to experience everything that God is going to do today. Please do not forget, reform her. All of the ladies in the comment section, make sure that you are making your way to Memphis, Tennessee for Reform Her. It's going to be an incredible time in the presence of the Lord. Megan Ashley is going to be with us. Pastor Tasha Cobbs Leonard is going to be with us. Kamara Gardner is going to be with us. Teresa Allison is going to be with us. Keisa Cephas is going to be with us. And obviously, last but not least, the wonderful Christabel Clack is going to be leading the charge as we're going to see a tremendous deliverance breakout for all of God's daughters. It's going to be a great time. Make sure you are here for that. And make sure you don't miss a second of it. Everybody get your tithe together. Get your offering. If you were blessed today, I want to encourage you to get an offering together. You're going to see something potentially pop up on the lower thirds right beneath me. But you can text REFMEM to 1-888-364-GIVE. Or you can go to our Cash App, REFMEM, $REFMEM. But everybody, if you were blessed by this, I want to challenge you right now, everybody get a $10 offering in your hand. You can't buy a miracle and $10 wouldn't do it. Amen. But what I want to do is I just want to challenge you that you would start to move forward in your faith. And like I told you, sacrifice is all over the Bible. You're never going to be able to get away from it. And I don't want to curve what God is doing because we're afraid to tell you to sacrifice. All right. So get your offering together. Do not forget, reform her. Be on time to church, 9 a.m. And we'll see you again next time. Peace.